All right? And this wasn't just in Israel and in Egypt and in that area. It was in America. It was in Australia. It was all over the world. There was a strange behavior occurring with the sun. And the reason, we can say, well, what happened back there in the second millennium BC?
Global warming.
It might have been global warming. I think more that it was going through the tail of a comet. That's my view and a lot of other people's view as well. And it is called, in some circles, the age of gravel. And of course, it was. Because periodically, gravel would fall out of the sky, fiery meteorites, and, you know, the place was, the earth was brought to the brink of utter destruction. And why? Because Israel was told by God that all the nations will know of what I've done for you. God will move the universe for his people. And he has done so on many an occasion, including the second millennium BCE. So it was a very precarious age. There is no doubt of that in my mind. And a lot of people are now reevaluating that whole millennium. And you find hints all the way through the prophets who lived at that time that it was anything but normal life in the second millennium BCE. So this brings me to my mini lecture today about this particular Parsha reading, and they're on the plains of Moab. They're looking across. The sun has reappeared, and how timely. God wants to shine on the promised land, okay? The first place to have the sun. It beams down, and Israel's going, wow, you know, we've been in darkness for 40 years. Now look at that place. It's worth having. It's worth having. Numbers 33, verse 1. Please look carefully at this, because my whole mini lecture today is on this particular verse. Numbers 33, verse 1. And the reason I'm going to make a point of this is because some good people stumble over the wording of the text. It says, these are the journeys of the children of Israel who went forth from the land of Egypt. And then it lists 42 encampments, okay, and 42 journeys in this 40-year period of time. They say, these critics say, well, whoever wrote this should have said, this is a record of the journey. This is a record of the journey. But he doesn't. He writes in the plural, these are the journeys of the children of Israel who went forth from the land of Egypt. Well, how many times can you go forth from the land of Egypt? Here is when the rabbis say, well, hang on, there's more to this than meets the eye. You can only leave Egypt once, but here it's implied they're leaving Egypt over and over and over and over and over. Every time they encamp, then they have to get up and move again. They're leaving Egypt again. So that's why it's in the plural. Surely after the first stage of the journey, after they had arrived in Ramesses, they were no longer leaving Egypt, but Ramesses. And so on, for 42 more encampments. The simple answer to this query is that until a person arrives at the ultimate goal, now hear me, until a person arrives at the ultimate goal, and Israel, in a spiritual sense, was arriving at the promised land, all right, spiritual as well as physical sense. Until we arrive where we are going, where we are intending to get to, we are always still in the process of leaving Egypt. And why is that? Because Egypt remains in our heart. Egypt remains in our heart. It's the same as our journey to the kingdom of God. Yeshua said, seek you first. And the Greek means first, foremost, completely, totally. Seek always and at all times the kingdom of God. And all these other things, he says, will be added. But we don't. We seek all the additions first. And the kingdom of God sort of occupies the background of where we're coming from in our heads. And every time we have an experience or a temptation or a trial that hits us unexpectedly, and they're always unexpected, it's always out of left field, there is a desire within us to return to Egypt, to escape our present reality and traverse back to our source of captivity. It's easier to do that. It's easier to do that. So we're going to be continually on our guard in relation to this situation. Turn over to 2 Peter. 2 Peter chapter 2 and verse 20. Because this was happening in the first century among the ecclesias of God way back there in the first century, where they thought the end of the world had come. We know now they were wrong, because it didn't come then. It's coming now. They're 2,000 years out. But Peter wrote this: if they have escaped the corruption of the world by the knowledge of our Lord and Saviour, Yeshua the Messiah, and are again entangled in it and overcome, they are worse off at the end than they were at the beginning. We've seen it over and over. We see it repeated. People will leave the congregation and go back to what they had come out of. And Peter goes on to say, it would have been better for them not to have known the way of righteousness than, having known it, to turn away from the holy command delivered to them. And he says, and this isn't very complimentary, it's not meant to be, it has happened to them according to the true proverb, a dog returns to its own vomit, and a sow, after washing, returns to wallowing in the mire. Now, I don't know about you, but I've got two dogs, and I've seen Pepper gulp it down, gulp, gulp, gulp. See, dogs don't chew their food. They gulp. And what happens to it?
It sits in there for a while.
Unfortunately, it doesn't come straight up. Oh, no, no. And it's always when you go out to see what's happening. They don't time it any other time. And you go out and it goes, look, look, look. And out it comes. And you go, no. And the stench. And how is it? There's always peas and carrots in it. They don't eat peas and carrots. So how long have they been in there?
That's right. And peanuts without a tooth mark in them at all.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Right? Awful. And then they go back and they eat it. At which time, I'm coming in and just closing the door and saying, Glenys, I really need a stiff drink. Because this is, it's awful to see them do this. But this is what Peter says of believers. Then we might go, oh, well, these are apostates. You can have apostate believers. It doesn't mean they're going to lose eternal life. It doesn't mean everlasting life's going to be taken. But they're going to experience some difficulty in life as a result of the rejection of the message of grace, all right?
The wages of sin.
Well, absolutely. Dying, you shall die. It's a process. So Peter is talking about ordinary human beings who trust in Messiah, yet are brought into devastating captivity worse than they had when they were without him. How do I know that they're true believers? Well, the word knowledge here is epignosis. Epignosis means a full and complete salvific knowledge. Not a superficial knowledge, but a full, complete understanding of what God wants. And as the Haftorah on Jeremiah makes candidly plain, God will send judgment on apostates and turn them out into a captivity of their own passions. He'll turn them over to what they want. Why? Because God doesn't control us. Sometimes we try to control him through prayers. We dictate to God what we want. Yeah. And God's up there going, I'm going to give you the opposite. Haven't you ever done that? You pray for a specific thing, and what happens is the reverse. You go, whoa, what happened there? Well, God's saying, hello, can you hear me? You pray for what I want in your life, not what you necessarily want. And there are times when God does answer you and he answers positively, and I'm so glad that that happens.
Yeah.
But there are the times when God says, underneath all of this, you've got this drive, you've got this desire, you've got this carnality, you've got this desire to return to the cesspools of Egypt. I'm going to give that to you. Wallow in it.
And he gave them what they wanted, but sent leanness in
their spirits, in their souls. Absolutely. So, what is our Egypt? We've got to ask that question. What is our Egypt? What is it? What is it that so easily captivates us? And remember, captivate means to be brought into captivity. We use captivate, you know, we misuse. I'm often saying, my wife captivates me. I shouldn't, well, I suppose I should say it. I'm happy to be brought into captivity, I better say it. But there are other times we use captivity, captivate, and we shouldn't be using it.